Since the beginning of the Golden Age, there has been one company who's pioneered the field of animation into the global force it is today. The man responsible for truly bringing animation into the mainstream was Walt Disney, along with his older brother Roy. In this first of three parts, Joe and I are going to look into the lives of the men who challenged the notion of cartoons only being pleasing enough for shorts, as opposed to full-length features. You're going to see the highs and lows of this remarkable team. As always, please remember to like, share, and subscribe. Remember to also become a patron on Patreon to help us put out more great content. Without further ado, I'm Big Rob, and this is a look into the Disney Brothers. Enjoy. Roy Oliver Disney was born on June 24, 1893, while Walter Elias Disney was born on December 5, 1901. Roy was the third child born after his brothers Herbert and Raymond. After Walt was born, a fifth child, Ruth, was born. Roy and Walt would have both similar and different experiences growing up. Their parents, Elias and Flora, moved everyone from Chicago to Kansas City, Missouri in 1906. There, Elias purchased a newspaper delivery route for the Kansas City Star. Roy and Walt would have jobs as newspaper delivery boys until Roy graduated from high school and went to work on a farm. In 1917, Roy joined the United States Navy and served for 2 years before tuberculosis medically discharged him. At the same time, Walt attempted to join but was told he was too young. He didn't let this deter him, however, and forged the date of birth on his birth certificate to join the Red Cross. Walt was made an ambulance driver and shipped to France after the armistice of 1918. Walt would show a talent for drawing cartoons, and even drew one on the side of his ambulance. Some of his work was even published in the Army newspaper, Stars and Stripes. After being discharged due to tuberculosis, Roy relocated to Los Angeles and became a banker while recovering in the hospital. As for Walt, he returned to Kansas City in 1919, and became an apprentice artist at the Pessman Rubin Commercial Art Studio. He honed his craft at the studio and also befriended someone who would help revolutionize the world of animation with Disney, Ube Iwerks. Walt and Ube were laid off in 1920 after profits declined for the studio and decided to start their own company. This new company would be called Iwerks Disney Commercial Artist. The company, however, was short-lived, and the two ended up working for the Kansas City Film Ad Company. There, Walt became interested in animation when he saw the work being produced at the company. They used cutout animation, as opposed to the hand-drawn animation technique Walt preferred. Cartoons at the time that interested the future mogul included Mutt and Jeff and Coco the Clown. After getting his hands on a camera and experimenting at home, Walt saw that cel animation was the way of the future, though he couldn't get his boss on board. Walt Disney decided to form a new company with his co-worker Fred Harmon. Newman Theatre was their biggest client, so they produced short cartoons called Newman's Laughograms. Soon, Harmon's brother Hugh, animator Rudolph Ising, and Ube Iwerks joined the company. Walt soon put Alice's Adventures in Wonderland into production to earn a profit. It was an early experiment to combine live action and animation. He cast actress Virginia Davis in the title role, but the film was completed too late and the company went into bankruptcy in 1923. Things took an upward swing when Walt decided to join his brother Roy in Hollywood. He even found someone to buy Alice's Adventures in Wonderland from him, producer and New York film distributor, Margaret J. Winkler. She was instrumental during this time period, as she was the first woman to ever produce and distribute animated films. She had by this time produced Out of the Inkwell and Felix the Cat, and was looking for something new. Walt and Margaret would sign a contract for her to produce a series of Alice shorts and convinced Virginia Davis and her family to relocate to Hollywood. Finally, both Walt and Roy formed the Disney Brothers Studio, which would later be renamed to the Walt Disney Company. The Alice series was successful, but by 1927, Walt had decided to focus his attention to shorts that were all animated as opposed to a combination of live action and animation. He and Oob Iwerks, whom he had brought over to his new company, created Oswald the Lucky Rabbit and distributed their new character through Universal. Margaret Winkler's husband, Charles Mintz, had been handed the reins to the Alice shorts and had a strange relationship with Walt. The biggest thing that strained their relationship, in my opinion, was when he not only wanted to reduce Walt and Oob's payments for producing the Oswald shorts, he also convinced certain animators to work directly for him, such as Fred Harmon, Rudolph Ising, Carmen Maxwell, and Friz Freleng. To make matters worse, Walt discovered that Universal owned the intellectual property rights to Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. Mintz made both Walt and Oob an offer that both rejected. This loyalty to each other would pay dividends. In 1928, Walt Disney and Oob Iwerks worked secretly to create a new character to replace Oswald. They decided upon a mouse, though why is unclear. Walt originally wanted to name the character Mortimer, but his wife Lillian thought the name was too pompous and suggested Mickey instead. They made two shorts, Playing Crazy and The Galloping Gaucho, but could not find a distributor. However, as the saying goes, third time's the charm. Their third short, Steamboat Willie, a parody of Buster Keaton's Steamboat Bill Jr., was produced with synchronized sound after Walt saw the 1927 film The Jazz Singer, the first film with synchronized sound. It became the first post-produced sound film and even had a professional composer and arranger, Carl Stalling, improve the quality of the music. Through him, the Silly Symphony series was produced. Steamboat Willie became a huge hit, and the Disney brothers started to climb the ladder of success. While Roy Disney took care of the business and financial side of things, Walt took care of the creative part, being a powerful team. The fact that they were brothers also helped, as it gave the two a trust not many partners had. Together, they brought more cartoons to life, such as more Mickey Mouse cartoons, and even produced a cartoon called Flowers and Trees, which was animated in full-color three-strip Technicolor. This cartoon would win the Academy Award for Best Short Subject Cartoon in 1932. Disney won this award the next year for The Three Little Pigs. However, Walt, never one to be satisfied and always wanting to go higher, decided to take the next logical step in animation, create a full-length feature cartoon. To say that people in Hollywood didn't believe in Walt's dream would be a massive understatement. His idea to produce a full-length cartoon called Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs was dubbed Disney's Folly. Walt was too determined to give up, though. He spared no expense, even going three times over budget. To make the animation look as realistic as possible, Walt sent his animators to the Chouinard Art Institute, and even brought in both animals and actors so his animators could study them to draw realistic movement. The animators also developed the multi-plane camera, which allowed drawings on a piece of glass to be set at various distances from the camera, creating an illusion of depth. This attention to detail paid off big time, as Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs became a sensational hit worldwide. Walt was presented with an Honorary Academy Award for the film, a second in this area, as the first was given to him for the creation of Mickey Mouse. From here, Walt Disney started a string of classic animated films that are still remembered today. These include Pinocchio, Fantasia, Dumbo, The Three Caballeros, Cinderella, Alice in Wonderland, Peter Pan, Lady and the Tramp, Sleeping Beauty, One 101 Dalmatians, The Sword in the Stone, and The Jungle Book. Roy Disney always made sure to use his savvy business skills to make sure the company did well. It can never be understated just how instrumental he was to his brother Walt. One could not have succeeded without the other. Their history before their partnership speaks to that. In fact, in Walt's own words,
"He's my big brother. And he's the one that, when I was a little fella, I used to go to with some of my wild ideas, and he'd either straighten me out, put me on the right path or something, or if he didn't agree with me, I'd work on it for years until I got him to agree with me. But I must say that we've had our little problems that way. That's been the proper balance that has been needed in our organization. And he watches out for the financial side of it, and the corporate side. And in this project, though, I'd just like to say that I didn't have to work very hard with him on this project. He was with me from the start. Now, whether that's good or bad, I don't know."
There are some darker sides to Walt Disney that I have to address, some truthful and others most likely false. A truthful dark side deals with an event that happened in 1941, when Disney animators went on strike during the production of Dumbo. It all started in 1938, when the Screen Cartoonists Guild was formed after a strike at Fleischer Studios. In only 3 years, the SCG was able to get contracts with every major cartoon studio except for both Disney and Leon Schlesinger Productions. Schlesinger eventually agreed to a contract after his animators went on strike, although he asked a very important question when he signed, and I quote, "What about Disney?" unquote. It was a fair question, as Disney had become the biggest and most successful animator on Earth. However, while the employees had the best pay and working conditions, things started to become uncomfortable when Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs became a mega hit. The profits allowed Walt to construct a larger studio in Burbank, but amenities such as the restaurant, gymnasium, and steam room were limited to the top people. Lower-leveled employees were segregated into separate buildings, where they were heavily policed. This frustration, along with the box office failures of Pinocchio and Fantasia, only grew when Walt fired people over the disappointing ticket sales. While you could say that Walt only did this to cut costs, it was said that the pay structure was very disorganized. Low-level employees would only see $12 a week, while top animators got $300 a week. Those on the bottom felt that they were contributing just as much as the top brass and wanted to be better compensated, but Walt refused to sign with the union. In fact, he gathered his 1,200 employees in his auditorium to give a speech that would be a massive miscalculation on the mogul's part. In his own words, and I quote, "In the 20 years I've spent in this business, I've weathered many storms. It's been far from easy sailing. It required a great deal of work, struggle, determination, competence, faith, and above all, unselfishness. Some people think we have a class distinction in the place. They wonder why some people get better seats in the theater than others. They wonder why some men get spaces in the parking lot and others don't. I have always felt and always will feel that the men that contribute most to the organization should, out of respect alone, enjoy some privileges. My first recommendation to the lot of you is this. Put your own house in order. You can't accomplish a damn thing by sitting around and waiting to be told everything. If you're not progressing as you should, instead of grumbling and growling, do something about it." Unquote. Needless to say, this did not go over well, and many employees joined the Screen Cartoonists Guild, including animator Art Babbitt, who became a union leader. Walt felt betrayed by this, as well as more than 200 animators striking on May 29, 1941. In retaliation, Walt depicted some of the striking employees as antagonistic circus clowns in Dumbo. However, even Walt Disney had to relent when the National Labor Relations Board asked him to sign a contract and he agreed. This would not be the end though. From this point on, Walt treated all of his union employees with contempt, and even ruined the careers of many of the people that participated in the strike by testifying to the House Un-American Activities Committee. He accused communism for the strike happening, and many animators were blacklisted, giving Walt a measure of victory, albeit a heartless one. Here's a recount of the strike from animator Bill Melendez, who eventually became the voice for Snoopy and Woodstock from the Peanuts cartoons.
And we were having a good time, and those inside were not having such a good time because we were so vocal and outside there, you know, walking back and forth and yelling at them. One of the girls really stopped me cold. I was going around, you know, real happy, and this girl comes out, very pretty girl, and she says, "What?" And she wasn't a striker, although we'd gone out on strike for her, see? And she said, "What is it you guys really want?" He said, "Money." And she had a fistful of pennies and he threw them at us. I said, "Jesus, if Walt had offered us that, we'd still be in there with you." But anyhow, that was the kind of a strike it was at the beginning. See, it was very cheerful and noisy. And but then Walt, going in and out, started snarling at us for some reason. And insulting Art Babbitt, our leader, who'd be out there, you know, on a mic, exhorting us to more action. And so, Walt took that really to heart. So from then on, every time Walt went through the line, we made life miserable for him. You know, we would holler at him. And he saw us. See, they took pictures of all of us. And whereas I had considered myself a good friend of Walt before, I could see that he took a dislike to me when he saw me, you know, jumping around, and I don't blame him. The difference was this. Later on, when I met other producers, for example, Leon Schlesinger, we struck him, and you know what? We had a lot of fun and cusses at each other, but as soon as the strike was over, we became friends again. Not with Walt. He took it to heart, so I knew we had hurt his feelings. How dare we go out on strike against him? And so the strike lasted for like about 3 months. And Walt, of course, was in no spirit or friendliness or anything to make, you know, make up with us. He just wanted to crush us. His brother, though, Roy Disney's a different kind of a man. And so I don't know how he did it, but somehow he got Walt out of the country. He encouraged Walt to go down to South America and do Saludos Amigos and do, you know, a lot of research. While he was gone, Roy settled the strike. He says, guys, come back and forget all this nonsense. And so we did. Well, Walt was gone, see. He must have been furious when he came back, but I still was friendly to him. I say, morning, Walt. I didn't say Mr. Disney anymore. He'd snarl a few words and keep on going, which was part of the fun. We're cartoonists, you know, that was great. I tell you, out of that cartoon strike, I wish I could, everybody was drawing great big cartoons. And even they took a lot of, you know, film of that strike. Because he was a curious strike. There'd never been a strike like that in Hollywood. But I think Walt, again, with his personality and his backing of being such a hero, the average person in the street and the popular, how could you strike Walt? My gosh, he's a saint, a hero that makes all these beautiful things for our children. It was easy, you know, we just went out on strike. But that changed the whole spirit, I think, of animation. In the rest of the studio, the rest of the industry, they didn't care. In fact, they supported the strike. They used to come out there, and even in little planes, and, you know, encourage us. And they used to, you know, at noon come out on the picket line with us or have lunch with us, because on the Knob, you know where that hospital is? We used to call it the Knob. That's where our strike camp was. We had a whole bunch of tents, and we had a kitchen, and a union of chefs or something. A union, they sent a cook up there to cook our meals. Wasn't that great? It was fun. So we picked up the camp and then went back to work.
The other dark side of Disney that is most likely false are the allegations that Walt was anti-Semitic. The accusations most likely started around 1938, when Walt invited Nazi propagandist Leni Riefenstahl to Hollywood to promote her film Olympia. The film documented the 1936 Summer Olympics, which was hosted in Berlin, Germany, an area controlled by the Nazis. Writer Neil Gabler, who became the first author to gain unrestricted access to the Disney archives, wrote that Disney was, and I quote, "not anti-Semitic in the conventional sense that we think of someone as being an anti-Semite," as well as, and I quote, "though Walt himself, in my estimation, was not anti-Semitic, nevertheless, he willingly allied himself with people who were anti-Semitic, meaning some members of the MPA-PAI, and that reputation stuck. He was never really able to expunge it throughout his life," unquote. The MPA-PAI, aka the Motion Picture Alliance for the Preservation of American Ideals, had members who were considered friendly witnesses during the House Un-American Activities Committee trials. Most of the people they accused of being communists were people of Jewish faith. Ironically, most of the people who testified against them were also Jewish, such as MGM head Louis B. Mayer and Warner Brothers executive Jack Warner. For Walt Disney, it was death by association as far as his reputation was concerned, which is why I believe the accusations of anti-Semitism still exist today. We may never know how he really felt, but not one employee of his ever accused him of being anti-Semitic. In the 1950s, Walt and Roy formed WED Enterprises, now known as Walt Disney Imagineering. Walt especially wanted to create his own amusement park and sent his Imagineers to study other parks and find out what their drawbacks were so they can make the perfect place. Finally, on July 17, 1955, Disneyland opened as a series of themed lands, all connected to the park's main street, which was a replica of his hometown Marceline. The connected areas were known as Adventureland, Frontierland, Fantasyland, and Tomorrowland. The park was a massive success and still lives on today. With the success of the park and the success of Disney's first daily television show, The Mickey Mouse Club, things couldn't have gone better for the veteran animator. In 1965, Walt announced plans for another theme park, Disney World. This new park would feature the Magic Kingdom, golf courses, resort hotels, and at the heart of the park, the experimental prototype community of tomorrow, or Epcot. He would never see this park realized, however, as heavy chain smoking throughout his life would cause him to have lung cancer. On December 15th, 1966, only 10 days after his 65th birthday, Walt Disney died. His big brother Roy, in honor of his brother, would complete the plan himself, holding off his retirement to take full control of the entire company. He would rename the park Walt Disney World in honor of Walt, which opened on October 1st, 1971. With Walt Disney World finally completed, Roy retired. However, he would pass away on December 20th, 1971, more than 2 months after the opening. The timing of his death has me wondering that maybe Roy passed away because he felt he had done his brother proud. He honored him by finishing his final project and seeing it become a success. The drive to finish Walt Disney World kept Roy alive, and seeing it open allowed him to have a much-deserved rest. Roy's son, Roy E. Disney, would become a senior executive for the company, eventually becoming director emeritus for the board of directors. Roy E. honored his father by rededicating a locomotive in Walt Disney World Railroad to him in 2002, many years after it was first dedicated to him. Roy and Walt Disney were a two to force. They started out with little to nothing and built an empire. They understood their roles perfectly. Roy was the business and financial man, and Walt was the creative visionary. It's hard to think of what Hollywood would look like without them. They redefined what animation could do and continue to inspire millions with their achievements, myself and Joe included. Honestly, the only thing we can think of to show our massive appreciation for their work is to simply say, thank you. We hope you've all enjoyed part one of this incredible journey with us. Part two will cover the classic Disney animated movies, and part three will look into the golden age live-action films. As a reminder, please like, share, and subscribe, as well as supporting our Patreon page. All links will be in the description box below. Until next time, on behalf of my partner Joe Lewis, I'm Big Rob, and we'll see you again soon.